Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, and welcome to this special celebration of teaching and learning. I'd like to thank the many dignitaries who are in attendance this morning, including Superintendent Patricia Chamberlain, Maeve O'Day from the Berkshire Taconic Community Foundation, 2009 Kapteyn winner Darren Baer, 2010 winner Sam Prouty, 2011 winner Charles Malcolm, 2012 winner Eric Moore. Thank you for us. I'd also especially like to recognize members of the Kapteyn family, including Molly Boxer and Kirsten Kapteyn, who are with us this afternoon. I'd be remiss also if we didn't take a moment just to thank the many people who made this event possible today, including our cafeteria staff, Sue and Kristen out there, Kevin Wheeler, Vance Cannon in the back working the lights and the sound today, and Darren Baird himself, who did a lot of the organizing for this, as well as the Ag-Ed department. Thank you, folks. I'd also like to take a moment to recognize Cindy and Alexa Curtis, who began the process of nominating Karen for the award. Alexa, a recent graduate of Housatonic, and her mother, Cindy, approached me about the award with a brief email, and with their help and the clandestine assistance of Karen's colleagues in the Agricultural Education Department, we embarked on months of whispered arrangements to prepare the application without Karen knowing. Thank you, folks. Appreciate the help. Let me make one thing clear. If Karen had known about this award, she could have stopped it. So much as this prize is a testament to her teaching, it's also a testament to the ability of her colleagues, Ashley Porter, David Moran, and Mark Burdick, to keep a secret. It's also a testament to the admiration and love that Karen's colleagues have for her. She is that rare mix of teacher, mentor, partner, counselor, mother, and friend that, as Cindy Curtis said in her original email to me, makes her the embodiment of everything this prize is meant to celebrate in an educator. Karen is indeed the consummate teacher. She cannot not be teaching at every opportunity. Thanks to her, my daughter knows what a gizzard is and how to properly hold a chicken. She fearlessly approaches our sheep and goats, and she knows when the moment is right to pick eggs from a chicken coop. She's seven, and she has never lived on a farm or been in an ag egg class, but Karen took the time in the midst of open houses and Goshen fairs to teach her how to do all those things. Consequently, Emily is checking out books from her school library about Lipizzaner and Tennessee walking horses, golden retrievers and St. Bernards, and developing a positive relationship with animals and nature that I hope will span the rest of her life. Many of you in the audience today can probably trace your passion for animals or agriculture back to Mrs. Davenport, and I hope you appreciate the opportunity afforded by today's ceremony. At some point during today's proceedings, take a moment to let Karen know just how far and wide her influence extends. Congratulations, Karen, on a well-deserved prize, and here's to many more years to come. I'd like now to ask Maeve O'Day from the Berkshire Taconic Community Foundation to come to the stage.
Kapteyn Prize Fund began at Berkshire Taconic in 2009. Jamie's family and friends came to the foundation with the dream of creating an annual prize in Jamie's memory, and the foundation provided the structure to make that dream a reality. This is an endowed fund, which means that this prize will be given to an outstanding teacher every year forever. We thank the Kapteyn Committee for building this fund. Every year, the foundation oversees the administration of the prize, notifying the schools, collecting applications, distributing them to the committee, ensuring that the selection process is carried out in accordance with the prize goals and criteria, and that it meets all legal requirements. Berkshire Taconic Community Foundation has been building stronger communities now for over 25 years, and many of the 520 funds we hold directly benefit the students of Region 1, including the Region 1 Athletic Fund, the Region 1 Arts Fund, the 21st Century Fund, the Artists for Artists Art Garage Fund, Education Enrichment Funds for Kent, Cornwall, Sharon, and Salisbury Schools, and the Derwin Butterbaugh Alumni Association and Teddy Lee Drum Scholarship Funds. Congratulations to Karen. You should know that teachers applied for this award from public and private schools throughout a 5-county area, and be proud that Karen was selected and recognized as an outstanding teacher in education. We salute Karen and all the teachers who support our students, and we salute Region 1 students who are the future of our communities. And I'd now like to welcome Molly Buxer, Kapteyn Committee member.
Here to celebrate and honor outstanding teachers. We were privileged to have a wonderful tour of the campus this morning and now have a much deeper understanding of what special place this is. I wrote these words before I actually came. I could go on and on about this place. You are so fortunate to be here. So thank you for welcoming us here today. Before we welcome and recognize this year's winner, it is my honor to tell you a little bit about the Kapteyn Prize. Darren is my helper here. So the Kapteyn Prize is given in honor of James Cornelius Kapteyn, Jamie. Here he is in Cambridge, actually, on invite, while he was studying for his master's in English degree from the Breadloaf School of Middlebury College. Jamie was a boarding school teacher through and through. He started at Cushing Academy, moved on to Northfield Mount Hermon, except that's not true. He started at Cushing Academy, maybe I will read after all, and then moved on to Williston Northampton School, and then on to Deerfield Academy, his alma mater, where he taught for 7 years. He taught English, was the sophomore class dean, coached varsity girls soccer and boys varsity lacrosse, lived in the boys' dorm with his wife Kirsten and his daughters Ingrid and Ilsa, Deerfield class of 2009 and 2013-ish, respectively. Ingrid and Ilsa. To his dedication to his students, Jamie was a devoted family man, an avid fly fisherman, an outdoorsman. And these passions spilled over into the classroom. Known for his quiet confidence, integrity, humility, and playful wit, Jamie will be remembered riding down Deerfield's Albany Road on his bike in his beret and barber jacket, greeting everyone he passed. Jamie's slow, unhurried grace raised him above everyone around him. But rather than look down at you, he lifted you up to him. This quote is from the eulogy given at Jamie's funeral service by Adam Reeves, a lifelong friend of Jamie's. And Adam is the driving force to establish the Kapteyn Prize to honor Jamie and keep his legacy alive. The Kapteyn Prize is modeled after Jamie's approach to teaching and working with students in high school. To that end, the Kapteyn Prize shall be awarded to candidates whose excellence in and passion for teaching and learning inspire their students to excel. Prize winners shall be individuals of exemplary character, integrity, and honor, who lead by example and impart to their students a lifelong love of learning and dedication to personal growth. The Kapteyn Prize winner exhibits exemplary character, integrity, honor, and leadership. stimulates and encourages early intellectual, athletic, artistic, and or other mature interests in their students. It teaches the whole child. I want to speak for a moment about triple threat. Triple threat is a term that originated in boarding schools, and it had to do with teachers who worked with students in the classroom, on the playing fields, and in the dorms. We on the Kapteyn Committee have really come to understand fully how public teachers also embody the triple threat in different ways, be it in the theater, or in the ag department, or any number of ways. And so we are delighted that the Kapteyn Prize has gone to a good mix of both private and public school teachers. We are delighted to be able to award the Kapteyn Prize recipient a prize of $10,000. This money is to be spent at the full discretion of the winner, and is intended to enrich the whole life of the teacher, to feed the soul and the passion of the recipient. In return, we ask the recipient to do the following. Attend the subsequent Kapteyn Prize Award ceremony so we can hear how they chose to spend their money. Join the selection committee for the next 5 years to help choose future winners. This piece is really key to the integrity of the prize, for these teachers bring an insight to the process along with great enthusiasm, appreciation, and understanding of the teaching process. And in addition, we ask them to attend future award ceremonies. The JCK Endowment Fund was created to help support the Kapteyn Prize, and as Maeve said, it was funded by gifts from family, friends, colleagues, former students, and their families, and anyone who would like to see the legacy of James C. Kapteyn continue for future generations of educators and students. In particular, I would like to recognize the outstanding contributions made by Adam Reeves himself and his family through the Blodgett Foundation. I would like to tell you a little bit about you're ahead of me.
Oops.
There we go. Thank
Sorry,
you.
I thought
you're not. So the chair of this committee is Adam Reeves. Adam and Jamie first became friends in kindergarten at Berkshire Country Day School, and then they went on to Deerfield together. And they formed a bond that would continue the rest of their lives. Adam is crushed not to be able to be here today. He takes great pleasure in all parts of this process. But as we all know, life has a way of getting in the way, and he is a federal prosecutor out in California and is in the middle of a trial right now, so couldn't get here. Hannah Thorne Cinelli. Sorry, Hannah. Hannah is Jamie's niece and webmaster to the JCKE website, and mother of Ezra, who at almost 3 is clearly following in his great uncle's footsteps towards greatness. James Dooley, classmate and close friend of Jamie's at Trinity College. Jamie is our treasurer and brings his financial acumen to our committee. Jamie also deeply regrets not being able to be here today, and in this case, it is his young son, Liam, who needs his attention. Kirsten Kapteyn, Jamie's widow and guiding light who continues to inspire us with her integrity and devotion to Jamie's memory. Kirsten will have the honor of presenting the prize to this year's recipient. Molly Kapteyn Boxer, that's me, Jamie's proud sister of Jamie, who as of last week has re-entered the teaching profession, I'm glad to say. And now just a few words about the past Kapteyn Prize recipients. Now we can go to that photo. Yay, Darren. Clearly Darren is no stranger here. A history teacher, football coach, theater director. Darren won the first annual Kapteyn Prize in 2009. He continually inspires not only his students, and I'm sure his colleagues, but the Kapteyn Committee itself with his unrelenting concern and commitment to teaching the whole child. We are thrilled that Darren holds the position of the first Kapteyn Prize winner. There were two Kapteyn Prize recipients, Lisa Baldwin, who is unable to be here today. I think she's with her daughter at some medical school function, and Sam Prouty. Lisa is a chemistry teacher at Monument Mountain Regional High School in Great Barrington. She also supervises the science department and has been a faculty advisor to student organizations such as the Student Senate, Community Council, Recycling Team, School Newspaper, and Science Competitions. She's an active member of numerous educational committees and boards and coordinates several extracurricular events and activities for her students. Sam, and if Sam would stand up. Formerly taught at the Hosha School in Lakeville, Connecticut, and is now at Buckingham Brown Nichols in Cambridge. His involvement with extracurricular activities extended to coaching, squash, softball, golf, and debate. In addition to being a boys' dorm head and member of a student faculty council and discipline committee, he was chosen to co-lead the Hotchkiss Antarctica expedition, which brought 85 students and 15 faculty members to Patagonia and Antarctica in the winter of 2008-2009. You know, I don't mean to minimize the effects of these teachers in the classroom, but it's both the classroom and the extracurricular activities that we're really looking for. In 2011, Charles Malcolm won the Kapteyn Prize. Humanities teacher at Northfield Mount Hermon, advisor, dorm parent, varsity soccer coach, and junior varsity baseball coach. He has created life-changing experiences for his students, allowing them to appreciate the meaning of their academic endeavors, value the gift of their education, and discover a lifelong passion for the world's incredible diversity. In addition, Charlie runs an amazing summer program at Camp Pemjowasset, AKA Camp Pemi for obvious reasons, and is also renowned for his coaching style and ethos well beyond his immediate playing area. Eric Mueller was our prize last year in 2012. Eric is a humanities teacher, drama director, formal choral director, English teacher, advisor, and much more, I'm quite sure, at Hawthorne Valley High School in Harlemville, New York. From directing plays to traveling with a senior class to Italy, Eric has helped his students to appreciate the, you know, I said the same sentence twice. He does the same thing as Charlie. Helps his students to value the gift of their education and discover a lifelong appreciation for the arts. As an advisor, he makes contact with his students every day, checking on their academic progress, their general well-being, and helping them set goals for their future. Many students have gone on to say that he was the most influential teacher even beyond the high school level. In a moment, we actually will have an opportunity to hear Eric speak. So, how does one become a Kapteyn Prize recipient? To begin the process, the Berkshire Taconic Community Foundation sends a letter out to the heads of the 70 or 80 high schools within that five-county region. This includes Litchfield, Columbia, Upper Dutchess, Northwest Dutchess, and Berkshire County, as well as Hamden County because of Jamie's ties to Deerfield. So the first step then is the heads are invited to nominate one teacher who embodies the characteristics outlined above by way of a letter to the Berkshire Taconic Foundation. Barring any conflict of interest, the teachers themselves are then invited to apply. The nominated teacher puts together a packet including at least one letter of recommendation from a colleague, one or more letters of recommendations from current or past students, and a written statement that answers the question, why do you teach? This packet then finds its way to the hands of the selection committee, who has the distinct pleasure of reading about each of these amazing teachers. I know I personally find the essay about why I teach not only informative about each individual, but incredibly moving, and I'm often brought to tears reading the heartfelt words of these dedicated souls. The selection committee meets several times by telephone, and then generally the process culminates with a phone interview with the top two candidates. The selection committee, is made up of representatives from the KP board, Kirsten and myself, as well as secondary school teachers, who by now, all of whom are past Kapteyn Prize winners, which is great. We have Kirsten Kapteyn and myself, and those who I've introduced, Darren, Lisa, Sam, Charlie, and Eric. I put this photo in because one of the things I love about this, which was a bit of a surprise to me, is how the prize winners are beginning to form their own community and enjoy talking with each other and learning about what each other does and shares ideas. And that to me is very exciting. Okay, now it is my great pleasure to introduce Eric Mueller from Harlem Valley School. Except that
gratitude. That's what I feel now. Gratius from the Latin, connected to grace, and the word goes all the way back to Sanskrit, grati, song of praise. And in my heart I have a song of praise for all the people who have organized this, for the Kapteyn family, and especially for James Kapteyn. Gratitude. A few weeks ago, at the beginning of the new school year, I had to talk to the high school, the whole school really, and the theme that I chose was circles. And that still holds true for me, because today is like the closing of another circle. Last year, I received the prize, and there I felt I was touched by grace. And this year, I'm standing here again. But so much has happened in the interim. The Kapteyn Award has changed me and has influenced me in very many different ways. For example, it made me look at my own teaching career. And so I began, and that was already like a week before I received the award, a memoir that would explore my own teaching. And I finished that memoir a few weeks ago, the rough draft, should I say. And it surprised me. And I think every teacher after a few years should do that. It was like a 300-page self-evaluation. Because one looks at one's strengths and weaknesses the challenges one has gone through, the colleagues one has worked with and is working with, and above all, the students and the parents. Some surprising discoveries. I realized that during my upbringing, my childhood, my adolescence, there were very many seminal points, seed moments, that made me realize that I was meant to be a teacher. Of course, I denied that. I did not want to be a teacher. I felt sorry for most of my teachers, and I disliked very many of my teachers. And I didn't want to be disliked to such an extent. Anyway, I also thought that I would write a memoir filled with kind of the horrors of education, dysfunction of education, like Burroughs running with scissors, where he talks about his dysfunctional youth. I was thinking of calling my book Running from the Rod. But when I began to write, I discovered while writing about the teachers that I had that no matter how much I disliked the lessons or them, I discovered that actually I also appreciated very many of them. I'll give you one example. So there was in seventh grade, back in South Africa, a teacher called Mr. Buta. And he used the rod very often. In fact, in that seventh grade alone, I was caned 21 times. We kept track, because we like to be like the most kind of competition. Not only that, he once pulled my hair so hard that a whole big chunk was ripped out, a whole big lock, that even my mother noticed and said, "What happened to you?" And I told her. Another time he came to me and he began strangling me that I turned blue in my face. Another time I was walking out, my friend and I, we were kind of joking, I don't know what we said, but suddenly he took our heads and banged them together, and literally I saw stars. So, I didn't really like him. Halfway through that year, my family, we traveled to Europe for a year, to Stuttgart, and to a very different school. There was no corporal punishment, nothing like that. And I then wrote Mr. Buta and my class a letter explaining what we do. For example, that we sing in a chorus. All the girls also do metalwork and woodwork. We play a lot of sports. We, the boys, also do knitting and sewing. And then, of course, the academic career. Well, he wrote me back a letter. And it's the only letter I've ever received from a teacher. And it was a very heartfelt letter. And recently I reread that letter and I was very moved, because he really did care for us and for our academics. So those are the kind of stories that I put into my memoir. I also thought of my very first time in the classroom. I was not intending to become a teacher, it just happened back in South Africa. My brother, he was teaching at Wits University a class for the Africans in the Soweto township. And they would come to Johannesburg to the university. One day he couldn't do it, and so he asked me to take his class. I was 19 at the time, and I said, "I don't really want to." And he said, "I'll give you some money." And so he told me that just give them these papers and write on the board what they need to do. That's it. So I went there Saturday morning, and I gave them the handouts. I had no idea what the handouts were about. I didn't look. and I wrote on the board the pages that they had to cover in their course. Well, there were about 15 to 20 students, most of them double my age, from Soweto, the township, all Africans. And then they asked me questions, and then I felt embarrassed. I couldn't answer any of the questions. I hadn't prepared myself. And to this day, I think back to that moment. As a teacher, you need to be prepared. You need to be accountable. You need to have responsibility. That was many years before I began teaching, and it's never left me. So, this is one side of the influence of the Kapteyn Award. The other is that I did get $10,000. That's a wonderful amount of money. And I said to myself, I would like to use that money to have something to do with my teaching, and as was said, to enrich my soul life so that I hopefully will become a better teacher. So three things. First, I love music and I love instruments. And so I began to use some of that money to buy instruments that I would be able to use in my history of music course to demonstrate different time periods, different cultures, kind of tonal, sonic geography, so that they really experience the instruments, even if I could not play it properly. And I have been able to use some of those instruments in the classroom. I also bought some quote-unquote noisemakers, idiophones, membranophones that I can use in my classes. And also to be able to use these instruments in the plays as sound effects and musical background and accompaniment. That is a great gift, a gift to me and hopefully the students. And I bought quite a few instruments. I mean, the music store in Hudson, where I bought not all, but many of the instruments, he then said, Eric, you're spending a lot of money here. Have you gotten hold of some more money? As I told them, they said, ah, trickle-down effect, wonderful. Well, another dream was fulfilled, and that is to return to South Africa, to be able to show my wife where I really come from, my roots, where I was born. It also coincided with this self-reflection of looking at my own life. So we were able to go back to South Africa, first time for me in 35 years, long time. When I lived there, it was apartheid. And for many, many years, for example, I taught Cry the Beloved Country, which deals with the segregation and the disease of apartheid. And to be able to go back there and to sit in restaurants together with Africans was absolutely wonderful. Not to have the benches where it says Europeans only or whites only. Not to see that anymore. That alone was a gift. So we went to Cape Town first, and I went to school there for a year. Went to visit some of the schools, also the Waldorf schools. And, you know, just now it was said that I, at the end of each day, I say goodbye to my advisees and talk to them. But so it happened that one of my advisees went on exchange to South Africa. And so I met up with her. And we had coffee at the Pink Cafe. And that to me is like a closing of another circle. But sometimes circles are even bigger. Because her host family, the woman who was her host mother, she asked her, do you know anybody from South Africa in in America, and she said, well, there's my mentor, my advisor. What's his name? Eric. Possibly Eric Mueller. Yeah, that's it. Mm-hmm. Now, it so happened that I knew her very well, 35 to 40 years ago, and she happened to be a student of my father, who's also a teacher, in his class in the Waldorf schools that go from first grade to eighth grade. So for 8 years, she had been his student. So it was wonderful to reconnect with her. In Cape Town, we also went, we had a wonderful time, but one of the most beautiful days is when we went to the Kirsten Bosch Botanical Garden. And there, that was a dedication to Kirsten and to the Kapteyn family. And should I say as well, that it, then rented a car and then went up the coast and one by one went to all the places where I lived, went to school, that I visited. And not a day went by when we did not mention your names. Not a day. It would not have been possible. It was a real, it's real gratitude to be able to go to the game reserve, see those wonderful animals. I even went to the hospital where I was born, to the place, to the beaches I visited. I went to the one school where there was Mr. Buerta. I asked whether I could look around that school, and they said yes. And I went to the classroom, and I looked in, and I saw the desk where I sat. Quite a moment. Also to the, when we asked at the reception's office whether we could look around, I walked out and in the hallway, I saw headmaster, and I realized, oh, it's the same hallway, same sign, and I asked my wife, take a photo of me, 40 plus years later. A moment of deja vu. Of course, I got cane in the headmaster's office also from the headmaster, not just Mr. Guter. One big difference was, during the apartheid time, it was a whites-only school, and now in the classrooms, Africans. Wonderful to see that. Filled with beautiful, young Africans. What a moment. So the trip to South Africa was rewarding, changed my life, made me reflect on teaching. I came back renewed. And so a year later, I can say honestly that I've renewed my vows to teaching. Yeats has a few lines. I'm not good at remembering poems. The last two lines go something like this. Let's see if I can get it right. I have spread my dreams beneath your feet. Tread softly because you tread on my dreams. We as teachers need to tread softly on the dreams of the children. And Karen Davenport was also on my mind, and I went to have a look around at the agricultural section here, saw the animals. But you have been in my mind as well, because our time is so disconnected from nature, and to have teachers who connect with agriculture, the animals, and to teach young people to care for the land, to care for the animals. That is sorely needed in our times. There's a book that I came across in South Africa called Great South African Teachers. And in that book, it talks about, the way it happened is that they wrote a letter in the newspapers asking students to write about their most favorite teachers. And so they collected all these submissions, and I have just finished reading the book. And there's something surprising, they said in the introduction, that was that, well, quite a few surprising elements. I'll just mention one. That in all these submissions about their beloved teachers, it didn't have to do with the academics, the testing, the exams, the grades. It had to be about who the teacher was, about the teacher being a life teacher, about the teacher encouraging the students, about the teacher caring and nurturing the student, telling them where they could change their lives, almost like a second parent, life teachers. And then I had to think of Karen and the other teachers who have received awards. If there were an American equivalent, people like Karen would definitely be in this book of great American teachers. Thank you.
Hello. Thank you. So I'm Kirsten Kapteyn, the spouse of the late Jamie Kapteyn of what would be 25 years now. Thank you so much, Eric, for making it clear to us how important and validating and motivating winning the Kapteyn Prize was for you, and how and sharing with us the meaningful ways that you used your money. Gratitude is exactly what we were trying to express to you by giving you the prize, and to all of our winners in the past. And so the circle comes back around as you're sharing your gratitude for all of your, the opportunity that winning gave you, and the opportunity it gave you for self-reflection and memoir, and all the people that influenced your life, people and places that you're grateful to have had in your life, and for the moment of renewal, renewing your vows to teaching. What more could we want as a Kapteyn Prize committee and board and organization? Gratitude is exactly what made Cindy and Alexa Curtis bring Karen to our attention. So thank you so much for doing that. Thank you all so much for being here today to show your gratitude to Karen and to celebrate her. It's a huge, huge pleasure and honor to be here with all of you in this incredible place where not only one, but two of our Kapteyn Prize winners do their extraordinary work. I wish so much that we could have celebrated you here in this place too, Darren. It was the beginning of what we were doing, and we didn't know what we were doing, because this is where we should have been at that time. I hope you've felt the love that we've felt being here today, as much as Karen has. I have to say that my husband would be blown away to know about this prize in his honor, and he would be incredibly humbled and grateful that we're, in his name, we are highlighting and rewarding an extraordinary teacher every year from this region. When Jamie died 6.5 years ago, there was an immediate outpouring of love for him, which was bittersweet affirmation of the power of his teaching legacy. More than 1,000 people came to his memorial service at Deerfield Academy in January of 2007. And joyfully, I can say, despite the passage of time, I continue to hear many times throughout the year, including yesterday from someone I ran into on the street in New York, people from past students and colleagues and parents of students who want to express their enduring fondness and reverence for him and gratitude for the life-changing relationships that they and their children, predominantly students, had with him. When Jamie and my daughter's elder daughter Ingrid graduated from the Juilliard School in New York this past spring, the keynote speaker at the ceremony was the three-time Emmy Award-winning actress Laura Linney, who went to Juilliard herself, and she, to my delight, her opening remarks spoke to me immediately of the Kapteyn Prize and of Jamie. She recounted the story about how journalists frequently asked her what the biggest break in her career was, and that they were always surprised, well, even shocked, by her reply that her biggest break was being admitted to Juilliard as a student, where extraordinary teachers made all the difference in her life. So her story reminded me of the monumental importance of the Kapteyn Prize and of a critical need to publicly recognize and encourage and reward exceptional teachers in this world for making the choice to be teachers. And what a stupendous sampling of candidates are brought to our attention every year. Wildly impressive and diverse applications come in from both men and women, from teachers across the disciplines, from, you know, Greek language and literature, to special needs, to math, to agricultural education, from teachers who've been teaching for a minimum of 7 years, but for as many as 40 or 45 years, from small schools and large schools and public schools and private schools from all over this region. And as I say every year, these people are marvels of humanity who day in and day out embody the ideals that the Kapteyn Prize was designed to recognize. And I've said this before too, but not to most of you, that I hope someday to publish a book of application excerpts, and because I know it would be a tear-jerking bestseller, and that would confirm the preeminent place of teachers in society. So this year, with 4 years of Kapteyn Prize review experience under our belts, we were prepared for the superb or superhuman quality and diversity of applications in our pool, and for the powerful emotions reading them, the recommendations and the personal statements would evoke in us. We were also braced for the excruciating challenge of choosing a winner. All of our candidates are always amazing and worthy, all of them. And we almost have to play eeny, meeny, miny, mo, you know, to create our ranking lists each year. In past years, by the end of the initial application reading time, after the first round, two finalists are come to the top, whom we interview by phone. This year, something highly unusual happened. The numbers were undeniable, no discussion necessary. Karen was the first choice in the first round. Little did Karen know when we interviewed her that she'd already won the 2013 prize. Of course, most of you know her much better than we do. I met her for the first time this morning. We all did on the board and committee during our tour, which Darren and she led us on. And this is an incredible place, which you all must be profoundly proud of. And the pride that Darren and Karen and the love of this place just oozed out of them during, and it brought this place to life for us. So thank you so much. Usually, just last year was the first time we'd been to the prize winner's school before making giving our award. And it's terrible because it's almost like creating a fiction in a way. And now we really get it. We really know. And thank you so much. As I anticipated, Karen's humility and integrity came forth during our meeting, during our tour, as much as they did in our application materials and on the phone. But they are immediately apparent in person, the same, you know, humbleness that made her not, that would have made her not pursue this prize had she not had so much support in advance. But these two qualities, integrity and humility, were hallmarks of my husband, and they're essential to all of our Kapteyn Prize winners. And the Karen that I'm having the privilege to get to know now is quick to shift responsibility and praise for her successes to those around her, and to express tremendous gratitude for all she has received as on her journey of teaching, especially to all of you all in this village that is so dear to her. And the love and pride that both of you have in this place that's so clear has translated in both of your cases into exceptional community and school leadership and into transformative student-teacher relationships, which is what we're here to celebrate. As former principal Matt Harnett wrote of Karen in his Kapteyn Prize nomination letter, "She's the consummate professional whom the words dedication, commitment, and excellence are translated into action on a daily basis. He says, I cannot speak highly enough of the skills, knowledge, and effort brought to this school and community by Mrs. Davenport. She is a teacher who keeps students and meeting their needs at the center of everything. She is focused on the whole child every day of every year." You all probably know her history. I had prepared to tell you, her passion for animals and animal science, it was central to her life by age 14. And her inspiration from her own teachers, all of our winners always talk about the inspiration of their own good teachers, as Eric did. During high school, by the end of high school, she already knew she wanted to teach and to teach at ag ed. And so she got both of her degrees and her teaching certification at the University of Connecticut. And she began teaching here in 1995. And she became chair of the department in 2002, right? She's known for her uncommon empathy, creativity, and humor. And she has over the years taught biotechnology, aquaculture, food and fiber, small gas engine maintenance, veterinary science, always grounded classroom lectures and textbook lessons in real life farm experience. But that kind of breadth, I've never even heard of some of those things, but it's amazing all that you know how to do. In keeping with Hoosie's three-pronged ag ed program, it combines traditional lab instruction, as you all know, with supervised agricultural experience and leadership skill development through FFA. And so she's also an FFA advisor and has overseen, I guess, more than 1,000 kids in their school to career progression. And she spends countless hours after school, you all know, and on nights and weekends, creating and managing opportunities and overseeing opportunities for students, conferences, workshops, contests, recreational activities, community service projects, and coordinating and overseeing work placements on the phone, in the field, at work sites, at students' homes, tapping her vast community resources to support her department's highly effective programs. And she also co-chairs the National Honor Society, which I think she revitalized, brought to the new levels here, and she coordinates positive behavioral interventions and support programs at school. She fulfills a lot of essential roles. And as if these responsibilities aren't consuming enough, she says she's even drawn outside of school to further mentoring of children in 4-H, Sunday school, in the New York Dairy Princess program, and as a coach for the Eastern New York Holstein Club's Dairy Quiz Bowl teams.
Not to mention Karen and her husband have raised two beautiful daughters and have an award-winning farm to take care of. I want to visit that soon too. She's superhuman human indeed. And apparently everyone teases her that she somehow is able to fit 36 hours into 24. That's what Mark Brick said anyway. But it's clear that the quality of her work never suffers for the quantity. Mark says she's the engine, he's her co-department chair, the engine that runs the ag ed department, deeply beloved by students, staff, and parents. One of the most dynamic teachers he's ever met, and who can challenge and motivate special needs kids as skillfully and lovingly as the class valedictorian right in the same classroom. Students depend on her for advice and support in both their academic and personal lives. She's a shoulder to cry on, always ready with a comforting hug. And as Mark explained, Karen has surmounted much personal tragedy in her life, surviving cancer and grappling with other family misfortunes and suffering. And she's emerged, by all accounts, with the most positive outlook on life, knowing each day must be treasured and made the most of. And all of her recommenders agree that Karen brings optimism to everything she does, and it rubs off on everyone around her. And that was so clear just on our tour, you know, your enthusiasm and your passion and your warmth. It's clear that Karen's hard-won wisdom feeds both her passion for teaching and learning, and in turn ignites and fans the essential fires in her students that William Butler Yeats so aptly cites in his definition of education: education is not the filling of a pail, but the lighting of a fire. In her application essay, Why I Teach, Karen tells a story of a former student that perfectly illustrates the extraordinary scope and power of her teaching. This former student, Caitlin, is Caitlin here? Who's now 25, was a shy ninth grader with a passion for the dairy cow when they first began working together. Karen encouraged Caitlin to follow her dream and taught her the ways of dairy science and animal husbandry, employing Hussey's three-pronged program, working with Caitlin, her parents, and her grandfather to chart her path to success. And Karen helped guide Caitlin in building a small dairy of her own, producing high-quality brown Swiss dairy cattle. And as Karen recounts, their journey took them from a win at the FFA state level to the national FFA contest, where Caitlin earned a gold medal with her dairy management skills. And their journey together continues. The day before Karen wrote her Kapteyn Prize essay, she visited Caitlin's farm with four of her current students. And she said they were clad in pink overalls. I need to hear that story. She said, these fledgling farmers learned about handling cows. So she's instilling excellence, and it carries on, and their relationships go on and on. This is true of all of our Kapteyn, and modeling for them as a farmer, an AgriMark member herself. Karen also wrote in her Kapteyn Prize essay, Why I Teach, I feel blessed to jump out of bed every day, excited to start a new day of school. I am indeed humbled and awed by the precious and influential privilege of teaching that I have made my life, affecting the whole child. My village truly embraces the whole child concept. And Karen acknowledges that when people ask her about her kids, she often has to ask them, which kids do you mean? My biological children or my students? Spend so much time with these students. And her students clearly feel the same way about her. And their bonds of trust and friendship, as we see, that they form during the school years that are so important, don't extend beyond graduation. And one of your recommenders, I think Sherry Boardman, said that it's common to see past, you know, graduates of your program in the hallways in the IED department, coming back to say hi, to get advice to someone who is so much more than a teacher to them.
Another student, Alexa, your words are very powerful and I want to share them with everyone. You graduated last year in 2012 and you wrote in your recommendation, "I will never really be able to fully thank Karen for the ways in which she helped me grow and become who I am today. Every single day of the 3 years I was in her class, Mrs. D challenged me to push through my fears, learn more, expect more of myself, believe in myself, and be who I wanted to be. She was able to take a kid like me, who had been bullied to the point of being incredibly nervous just to speak in front of a classroom of peers, to being able to compete at the district level public speaking competition. Mrs. D nominated and proudly watched me as I was inducted into the National Honor Society. Mrs. D was there throughout my high school experience to congratulate me when I did well on a difficult test, and to hug me and be a shoulder to cry on when my best friend was in and out of the hospital. She was my teacher, my advisor, my mentor, my boss, and most importantly, she became a second mom to me. Mrs. Davenport is the strongest, most dedicated, selfless, outstanding, caring, passionate individual I have and probably will ever meet. Karen is living out her dreams and encourages all of her students on a regular basis to do what makes them happy and live out their own dreams, because you only live once." As another one of Karen's peer recommenders said, Bonnie Moody concluded, "You hope your child has a teacher like Karen Davenport to become a better human being." Clearly for Karen, teaching is not just a job, but rather a way of life, an opportunity to inculcate core values in young people, to inspire them to embrace a life of constant change and self-renewal, and to seek meaning in serving others. Karen delights in interactions with young people regardless of the time or the place. She humbly, day in and day out, builds relationships with students, challenging them to excel in everything they undertake and to give back to their community. She loves her work and is work that matters profoundly, that changes lives. This year's Kapteyn Prize goes to a teacher who derives the same kind of joy and meaning in her work that my husband Jamie Kapteyn did. With the same unwavering commitment to young people, she carries on his mission and his legacy with every breath she takes, and we are honored to present her the 2013 Kapteyn Prize. As Melody Sandquist wrote so presciently, instead of giving awards to others, it is Karen's time to be the recipient. Yeah. Karen with this framed certificate recognizing her efforts for the 2013 Kapteyn Prize winner. She will receive a check for $10,000 soon. Huge congratulations and thank you. The only time in my life I've been speechless. This is as hard as Jared said it might be. So I'll probably just like read this because Eric, you did such an amazing job. I thought, how does he know where to go next? It's just the way, it's just beautiful. It's just beautiful. And gratitude is very definitely a word that comes to mind. But if you can imagine a life represented by a mosaic made up of different tiles that begins when we are young with very, very few pieces, but is filled in as we age and we experience new things. Some tiles are shiny and bright. Others are small and brittle. Still others are heavy and strong.
Well, the corners of my mosaic are made up of four very strong, sturdy, and colorful tiles. These represent special groups of people who have supported me to determine and nourish and then hone my life's work, and more importantly, my passion of education, and really, I guess, who I am. In one corner is my family. They are loving, supportive, patient, and always, always there in happy times and in sad as well. My husband Jim and daughter Laura are here today with Jim's mom, and she's really my mom too. His brothers, their wives, and two wonderful nieces, Megan and Allie. Sitting back there, Karen was like mama. My older daughter Kristen is in Colorado now, and she is following her dream of becoming a research veterinarian. There are earthen colors in this tile, browns and greens, with highlights of yellows and blues. This tile is wide, and it's thick, and it's elastic. In the opposite tile corner, the tile represents the family that I grew up with whom I keep in my memory with love and affection. But I'm proud to say that I'm the fourth generation of educators in this family, with my 101-year-old great aunt as my first teacher mentor. She taught for over 40 years and began in a one-room schoolhouse with 8 grades and a pot-bellied stove for heat. This tile is a cloud. It's like wisps of blues and whites and grays. It's a little fragile and sometimes bumpy. My third corner tile finds two very important men who saw in me enthusiasm for education. Patrick Horahan, my VOAG, before 1988 we were VOAG, now we're AGED, but he was my teacher from 1975 to 1979. He nourished the seed of an educator, and 5 years later, George Wheeler, my cooperating teacher here at Housatonic Valley, trimmed and pruned, supported and cared for my growth as an educator. After many years of mentorship and more as a colleague, George has been and continues to be an inspiring role model through his work, still in the classroom, in our community, in the FFA, both locally and nationally. This tile has deep primary colors and is strong and smooth. The tile in the fourth corner of my mosaic is multifaceted, seriously multifaceted. This tile imparts sound among its brethren tiles. Laughter is commonly heard from this tile. It has all the colors of the rainbow. It is bright and warm to the touch. Truly a unique tile. My AGED family is represented by this tile. Sarah and Mark, Dave and Ashley are my colleagues, team members, support group, sounding board, and above all, my AGED family. Bonnie Moody is also a part of this family, whether she likes it or not sometimes, and her absolute and complete dedication for teaching children in this place is amazing. We are challenged, tested, and evaluated daily, but our bond is synergistic, and we accomplish much for our students and the community through our combined efforts. I liken the tiles in the middle of my mosaic as elemental to the successes I have had and the lessons I have learned. These tiles are made up of hundreds of students, like thousands, I guess, that I've been blessed to share with. These amazing students, now veterinarians, dairy farmers, research scientists, or stable managers, veterinary technicians, AGED teachers, and many, many, many more. They're wonderful success stories of how the agricultural education model works. The AGED model, or the 3 points, as Kirsten denoted, is a time-tested, long time, decades, almost 100, more than 100 years now. It's a proven winner in a sea of various educational theories. And I think, James Kapteyn, would have appreciated our small but mighty population of agri-science and technology students, because the Ag-Ed model truly embodies caring for the whole child. Our program overlaps three key elements: learning in the classroom and laboratory, then practicing the lessons taught through the real world situations, and lastly, developing leadership skills to ensure success in the future. These elements, known as the FFA, Supervised Agricultural Experience Program, and the class lab component, help to form the whole child. Through this model, I've been able to watch an 18-year-old senior take her first radiograph at the veterinary clinic where she was employed. On a beautiful summer day over a decade ago, I was mesmerized by the way Chrissy, an excellent horsewoman in our equine science program at the time, gave my daughter Laura, at maybe about 7 or 8 years old, her very first riding lesson. Chrissy's goal was to work with horses as a riding instructor. I've been entertained and challenged during FFA officer retreats, like who could get to the top of the fire tower first, or could I really outrun the 17-year-old boy during a game of red light, green light? No, I didn't. A very special mother-daughter team, Cindy and Alexa, spent one chilly night huddled in blankets in the Ag-Ed barn, bringing in friends who were sitting right in front of them. And here they are, mom, not knowing much about the farm world or animals, coming from the city, and Alexa, who was so willing to help and learn. They were there helping our 700-pound sow give birth to more than 10 lively little piglets. Most recently, I was able to share an afternoon with two caring young dairy women, Krista and Nicole. We were feeding over 40 calves who were under 2 months old, and at that time of the day, those calves and the girls were pretty hungry. But their compassion and dedication to the well-being of the calves were impressive. These experiences and hundreds more, some of which I had written in the application, and I just across here, I'm thinking of all the stories that I could tell. They certainly have filled my mosaic with memories that will last a lifetime. These tiles are varied in color and texture and sound and maybe even smell, as the experience that they donate denote. Other memorable tiles in my mosaic represent the teachers, support staff, cafeteria ladies, secretaries, custodians, and others who help our kids grow and mature into amazing young women every single day. I truly believe that the northwest corner of Connecticut is a magical place. It's full of wonder, generosity, diversity of thought and action. Housatonic Valley Regional High School, quite small in student numbers, boasts more elective choices than most large urban and city schools. Our numerous and assorted sports teams have not only made playbook history, but they believe in sharing and supporting students from neighboring schools by becoming their teammates. So way to go, Hoosie football, and especially a hip hip hooray for Darren Bear, their amazing coach. We truly have the most dedicated and caring staff here at this high school. Some are here long before the day starts and many times long into the night. Of course, these tiles are blue and gold. Sometimes shiny, sometimes cloudy, but always changing. There are other groups who are represented here, our amazing FFA alumni who support our students day in and day out financially through work experience programs, as interviewers, the Ag-Ed Advisory Council, who really remind us of what's important and what's going on, in the world of agriculture. And I'm very proud to say that my church family is also represented, and I truly appreciate them being here. I feel incredibly honored and quite undeserving, actually, listening to these people up here. I have always felt as though I'm the one that's been reaping the benefits from what I do and who I am every day. I mean, if you look around this audience right now, all of you, in one way or the other, have touched the life of a child. And my hope is that we can renew our mission by working together to create an even more magical place, whether it's here, in other public schools, private schools, colleges. I hope to use the prize money to help make a little bit of a difference in the lives of people in other lands who suffer and work hard but aren't able to reap the benefits of their toil. And maybe it will be teaching a family to raise chickens. It's been my ultimate goal. Or to help a child read a book. These truly have been lifelong dreams, and with this gift and good friends here in the high school, I hope to make that a reality. So my newest tile, or experience, in the experience, has introduced me to people who are so committed to the potential of excellence in teachers, in all teachers. Although I have just met Kirsten and her family today, and the board, I feel as though I have known them for a very long time. The generosity and commitment to honoring a man who embodied the very essence of teaching by not filling the pail of education, but by lighting its fire, and excuse me, Mr. Yates, for not saying that exactly right, but it truly is the greatest tribute of all. We need to ignite the passion in these kids. So it's probably the only time my hands have been cold in about 10 years, just saying. thank you to all of you who took time out on this beautiful, beautiful Sunday day to share and tell stories of Jamie, of your present and former students, and your own experiences, be it the rod or not, in education. And I truly, truly am humbled. Thank you. Thank you.
Wow. What an inspirational day. Thank you to everybody, to Sam, to Charlie, to Darren, to Eric for your amazing words, for Karen. And I hope you all join us next year when we can hear how the Kapteyn Prize has enriched Karen's life at a location to be determined. And in the meantime, give us a little time and then check the Kapteyn Prize website and you'll see photos of today as well as more information about other Kapteyn Prize items. So thank you so much.